for that. I've been looking at some of the Islamic teachings. And as I look more about character of Muhammad, I see that Muhammad has been deceived by Satan.
Oh, all right.
He was witched. My question to you, as a Muslim, why do you still follow this guy?
Deceived by Satan, I disagree completely. You need to show me your evidence where Muhammad peace be upon him was deceived. That's your words. I followed him because not only me, he guided humanity. He bring humanity from darkness into light. I see, I learn about the person. I saw the Quran and his contemporaries, those who were ignorant people, he used to kill their newborn girls. He make them the light for the world. These people become knowledgeable, good human beings from darkness into light, and they spread the word of God to the whole world. So what I saw, what he gave to humanity, he gave all positive. So you saying that he was deceptive, that's the word you use?
He was witched.
He was witched. Now that is one incident you're talking about here. He was witchcraft by one Jewish man. He was witched, yeah? So that he was a human being. Allah just showed us he was just a human being like us. And that was also taken away by the verses of the Quran revealed. So he was a human being.
Okay, so.
In that sense he was. That doesn't mean he was teaching us something false. He was witched.
I can give you lots of things that he was teaching you lots of things false.
Please.
And also the guy
who
was making a claim last week that there is no any mistakes in the Quran. He owes me £1,000 and then he walked away. I'm still waiting for that. But it's my turn. I'm going to respond to what you said.
Right.
Can you just tell me what is the historical evidence that Muhammad stopped killing the babies, okay, girls, and now Muhammad gives them enlightening future? Because as I look at the Quran regarding the position of woman, I am very disturbed what Quran teaches about marriage, what Quran teaches about wives, what Quran teaches about woman as a human being. Also, it's not about how many occasions did Muhammad get witched. The point is, Muhammad, who's supposed to be the man of God, he's been witched. That's according to Islamic tradition. Of course, we all know magics and demons, according to Quran, comes from Satan. Therefore, Muhammad was under the influence of Satan. So I would love you to respond that occasion. Also, can you just make a quick point? Sorry.
I'm just trying to find the verse. When we say, do not kill your... The girl. There's a verse in the Quran. We say is that those girls who you kill will ask you on the day of judgment, why you kill me? Why do you kill us? So there's a verse telling us should not. Okay, now you're putting me on the spot now, isn't it? I'm not prepared for that. You don't know the verse.
You come to Speaker's Corner week after week. Those are the basics. And if that is the reason why you follow Muhammad, you should be able to know the verse that quickly.
Yeah, I don't memorize. You know, I'm not half of the Quran. I'm not a memorizer of the Quran.
I don't care what is your job. Last week I offered you to be Allah. It doesn't look like you took up that job because people still don't worship you today. But last week you knew much better than Allah. So.
What did I say that I know better than Allah? What did I say?
Well, Allah didn't. Allah was respecting the Bible. You weren't. So.
No, I was just refuting.
I would love you to first deal with the witched, how Muhammad was witched, and what is the implications of that, and then we move to your point.
You are making the point. Tell me where he was witched.
You don't know.
No, you tell me, you're making the point.
Aisha narrated,
yes.
Bukhari 3175.
Yeah.
Once the Prophet was bewitched, so that he began to imagine that he had done a thing which in fact he had not done. Sahih Bukhari 5765.
Yes.
Aisha narrated. Magic was worked on Allah's apostle so that he used to think that he had a sexual relations with his wife while he actually had not. So, according to Surato, magic comes from the demon. Okay?
Yeah.
What kind of man of God, what kind of prophet, what kind of perfect example is capable to stay under the magic while Quran says in Surah 16, you are if you are influence of the Satan, then you are friend with the Satan. Those who seek refuge in Allah, Allah will look after them. Surah 16, 19, 18, 200.
98 to 100. Okay, let's see that what they're saying there. Because you're putting a lot of things in the middle here. Can we do one by one, one thing at a time? Because you're throwing a lot of things in here.
In that case, let's do one point, one point.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so pick one point, respond to that, and then
we talk about it. This one, Surah 16.
Okay, in that case, I'll make that point, okay?
Make
that Surah 16, verse 98 to 100 states, when you recite the Quran, seek refuge in Allah from Satan. This is Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah Shaitanir Rajim part, okay? They expel from his mercy. Indeed, there is for him no authority over those who have believed and relied in their Lord. His authority is only over those who have taken him as a friend and those who taught his associate others with Allah. What do you understand from this verse?
He has power only over those who take him as their patron.
As a friend, yeah.
Yeah, and who, under his influence, associate others with Allah in his divinity. It's so clear.
So, people who are under the influence of the Satan, they are the people. They are people who are friends with Satan, and they are the people who also associate partners with Satan.
Wrong understanding. It's clearly saying that. Read carefully. Don't put your words in it. He has power, yeah, only over those, talking about Satan. Satan has power only over those who take him as their patron. First thing, those who believe in him, those who think he is their friend. Those who think Satan is their friend, he has power over them. And who else? And who under his influence associate others with Allah in his divinity. The second category is, those, when they are under the influence of Satan, they associate partners with Allah.
Okay.
Not only saying that, when they are under the influence of Satan. No.
So it's if you do not seek refuge in Allah, that's your position.
Let me make my point. If you, so you are under the influence of Satan, and you worship other than Allah, then he has control over you. It doesn't say that if you are under the influence of Satan, he has power over you. No. It clearly says that those who are under his influence associate
are friends with him.
Okay, first point is those who are friends with him. And we know Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi never claimed to be a friend of Satan. Is the
Let's
opposite.
See. No, no, yeah, that's what we are going to examine right now. Okay,
yeah, so
that's your first point. Let me respond to your first point. Okay?
No, you make the two points, so let me clarify both points here. First of all, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi was not a friend of Satan. That's what the category. Second category is those who are under the influence of Satan, they associate others than Allah in his divinity. Now you need to show, then if Muhammad ﷺ was under the influence of Satan, I don't agree that he was under the influence of Satan. But even if he was, did he worship anybody other than Allah when he was on, we need to prove that.
Okay.
So he doesn't have a power of Muhammad ﷺ.
Okay. So, we know Muhammad has been witched.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
And we know when Muhammad was under the spell of magic, we know magic comes from the demon, which is linked with the Satan. And we know from the Islamic tradition, for the story of the Surah 53, Muhammad worshipped the pagan gods, which he committed shirk, therefore he is friend with the Satan. Surah 53.
Yes, can
sure.
You read that? Because it's your word, a Quranic word. I, in my opinion, you're putting words into the Quran. What's that? It's the Quran?
I'm gonna read
what's
the Surah
that?
53.
Is that Bible and the Quran?
Sir, I'm gonna read the
no,
Surah
no,
63.
On the floor. Is the Bible?
I don't worship a book, sir.
No. Is the Bible and the Quran?
Sir,
okay, I'm gonna
read the verse for you, okay?
Easy. While she's looking for it, you know, last week me and her had a kind of a debate, yeah? The video was deleted. I wonder why.
No, it wasn't deleted. I took it down.
Yeah, she took it down, the video. The last week.
Listen, what is the reason I took the last week's video down?
I know there was a little sound problem, but a lot of it you could hear. I think the video was like 1 hour or so, and the sound was only for maybe 20 minutes. There's still enough video can be left to see. I think Hatun really lost that one. Yes, Hatun, you lost that one, yeah?
Sir, you know I won that debate.
No, I'm just joking. After Hatun won
the reason,
it. It was still good.
The reason the debate was taken, a video is taken down, because there was approximately 20 minutes or 10 minutes. There was like time, there was no sound.
Yeah.
When I watched it first, I decided to keep it. But when I watched it, there was a long time you were making a point and there was no sound.
Right.
And then when you finish your point, I just told you, maybe you should be Allah then. So because people don't hear your point, it will just it would be very biased. Like if I didn't make the video, I would say like someone just took it off.
I'll take your word for it. Fair enough.
That was the reason it was taking down.
That's all right. Okay.
So
hello, John.
Hello, sir.
You're not Muslim yet?
No, of course not.
You never know.
No.
Keep looking for it.
I do. Say that.
We're just having a little debate.
What on?
We are talking about Muhammad and satanic verses of the Quran.
Muhammad and Satan.
Satanic verses.
Satanic. Oh,
holy. Satanic verses. Yeah. Yes.
So, I'm going to read it from the biography of Muhammad. It's with me. I'm going to show it to you as well.
I read it myself. That's okay. You can just read it from there.
Muhammad.
So, Muhammad's engagement with pagan gods and how Muhammad worshipped pagan gods.
Yes.
And how the satanic verses are revealed.
Yes.
Oh, I need to remember the page number. No, I think it's 165, but yeah, it's here.
So you didn't find it there?
I've got the book here. So when you show it from the book, it looks more...
Yeah, what book is it?
Reliable. Biography of Muhammad.
By who?
Ibn Ishaq, Ibn Hisham.
Ibn Hisham. We say A. Ghulam.
That's the translator.
He translated Ghulam. Ibn Hisham.
Yeah.
Ibn Hisham.
I'm sure you read it.
I have read passages of it, yes.
Yeah. So I'm sure you trust it because that is one of the earliest biography of Muhammad.
Don't say that, I trust it. Don't say that.
That's one of the earliest biography of Muhammad you have.
I'm going to refute if what he says. I'm going to refute him as well. Don't say I trust him.
Yeah, let's see. So, do you want to read it all for us since your English is like better, and then we talk about it?
You read it.
You want me to read it, all of it? Okay.
You don't have to really just say what it says. You can paraphrase it.
Okay, overall, it talks about Muhammad receives this revelation, okay? And then when he receives revelation, he talks about the pagan gods, and then he worshipped the pagan gods.
Shall I read the verses?
Yeah.
So you know what we're talking about, yeah?
Surah 53,
verse 19. Onward, yeah?
Yeah.
Have you ever thought about Allah and Al-Uzza? And about the third deity, Al-Mannar. Shall you have the male issues and he the female issues? That is indeed an unfair division. These are nothing but names that you and your forefathers have invented, for which Allah has sent down no authority. They are merely following their conjecture and their carnal desires, although guidance has come to them from their Lord. Is it enough?
So, as it talks about the three gods,
yes.
Okay, who are those gods?
Allah.
Who are they?
Al-Uzza and Mannar.
Who are they? Who are worshipping those gods?
Pagans, of course.
Meccan pagans.
Yes, yeah, Meccan pagans, yes.
And what is Muhammad saying to them?
Allah is saying, not Muhammad. You must remember this is a revelation of Allah to Muhammad.
What is Muhammad claiming to receive from Allah and saying to them?
These are the words of Allah. So Allah is saying, have you ever thought about Allah and Al-Uzza? And about the third deity, Al-Mannar? Shall you have male issues and he the female issues? That is indeed an unfair division. These are nothing. Now this is the important one. These are nothing but names that you and your forefathers have invented. for which Allah has sent down no authority. They are merely following their conjectures and their carnal desires, although guidance has come to them from their Lord. Allah is clearly saying that your fathers, forefathers and you had made these names. Whatever claims you're making, they thought they were gods. Allah has given you no authority. So okay. This is the stance of the Quran.
So let me read it for you, okay?
What are you reading?
So, then God revealed, okay, by the stars when it sets, you come there, does not err, nor the, he deceived, nor does speak out of
what
his desire.
Reading,
just a moment, just a moment, let me
reading?
Finish. I'm reading from the Tabari, page 107.
Tabari, okay? Commentary of these verses.
Yeah. Okay. And when he come to the words, okay, have you thought upon Alat, Al-Uzra, Manat, the third of three? Satan cast on his tongue because of his inner debates and his desires to bring his people to words. Those are the flying cranes. Verily, their intercession is accepted with approval. Can you just show me this verse from the Quran?
No, I'm trying to give you a look.
It's not in the
53,
Quran.
Verse 19. Can you read the, find the verse from the Quran?
19 okay? Says, have you ever thought about Allah and Al-Uzza?
Yeah, it. And the coming verses, those are the high fly cranes. Verily, their intercession is accepted with approval.
That's not, that's not in the Quran.
That's not in the Quran.
No, it's not in the Quran.
But that's the, how the revelation came. And then what happens is Muhammad bows down and worships those people, the pagans, okay? After that...
Show us where it says that he worshiped them. First
when
of all,
Quraysh, I'm reading, okay? In that case, let me read it. When Quraysh heard this, they rejoiced and were happy and delighted at the way in which he spoke of their gods, okay? And they listened to him. While the Muslims having completely trusted in their prophets in respect of the messages which he brought from God, did not suspected him of any errors, illusions or mistakes. When he come to the prostration, having completed the surah, he prostrated himself and the Muslims did the likewise. Following their prophet, trusting in their message which he had brought, and following his examples. Those polytheists of the Quraysh and others who were in the mosque likewise prostrated themselves because of the reference of their gods, which they had heard, so that there was no one in the mosque, believer or unbeliever, who did not prostrate, you know what I mean, himself. The one exception is Al-Walid, one of the guys who doesn't did, okay? So, Muhammad talks about those Quraysh's three gods.
Yes.
Not only Muhammad, but all Muslim community worships these three gods.
You finish?
So, if you made a claim that Muhammad had never conversation with Satan, and also traditionally this known as the satanic verses, can you explain it to me why Muhammad is committing shirk, which Surah 16 says people who are commit shirk are the friend of Satan? So why do you follow man who is the friend of Satan?
Okay, now it's a red herring you're throwing into the last question. Let's deal with what your understanding of this Surah chapter 53 is. Now you make a claim that Tabari says the satanic verses came to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which later on was deleted from the Quran. That's what you're implying, yeah? Tabari says that. The verses came, which says these are the cranes of God, and in the middle you can worship them, the daughters of God. Now, you're talking in
okay.
My time. It's my time now.
Can I clarify?
No, you can do it in your time.
Okay.
Because you're interrupting me, then I'm going to forget what I'm going to say. First of all, you need to show me the evidence from the Quran or from Sahih narration, Sahih Hadith, that took place. What you read was a commentary of Tabari. Tabari taking from Ibn Hisham. Ibn Hisham was a biographer. He was not a muhaddis. He was not a scholar of fiqh. He was a biographer. He says something. We don't take the word of Ibn Hisham as the word of God. Our yardstick is the Quran. So you need to show me from the Quran where it says, oh yes, oh Muhammad, you made a mistake. Now I'm correcting you. There's nothing like that. Second, in the Hadith, you can't find this thing in the Hadith that Muhammad ﷺ make a mistake. Not in the authentic Hadith. Now the end point you make, that Muhammad ﷺ worshipped, he bowed down, so everybody bowed down. But you're saying he worshipped those Allah, Manat and Uzza. But even the commentary didn't say that. Didn't say that he worshipped. What commentary says, when the surah finished, the chapter finished, then Muhammad ﷺ bowed down. And there is a reason for that. But you didn't even bother to look into it. Why? If you read that surah, you go right to the end. You know what meaning of sajdatul kirat? In Islam, it says sajdatul kirat. Prostration on recitation. What that means? Whenever there's certain verses come in the Quran, we are obliged to prostrate. They happen about 14 to 19 times in the Quran. Now, the very end of the surah, that verse occurs, which says, the last verse, prostrate yourselves before Allah and serve Him. That's what the Tabari is saying, that when the surah ended, Muhammad ﷺ prostrated. Why? Because that's what he read. You see this? I'm showing you something now, you didn't know that. You see this mark here? You won't find it any other verse, but when it comes to recitation, verse of recitation comes, this mark show us now is the time to prostrate. So he prostrated to Allah on this verse. He didn't worship those gods as you're implying. Read that commentary again so you understand. He's saying when the surah finished, Muhammad ﷺ prostrated, all Muslims prostrated. Now the question is, why the idol worshippers, pagans, why are they prostrated? Because they never rejected Allah as their God. They say Allah is their God, Al-Manat is their God, Allah is God, Hubal is their God, all different gods. They include Allah among those 360. So they didn't, for them it was not a big deal to bow down. But why Muslims and Muhammad ﷺ bowed down? Because of the last verse, and because that was the command was. Prostrate yourselves before Allah and serve Him. That's where the surah ends. So this is the answer to your query, why he bowed down. Never say he worshipped the pagan gods.
Let me respond. I am amazed, Abbas. Once again, you are forcing your loving view of Muhammad into the Quran. Once again, you are thinking, oh, Muhammad is perfect guy. Let me help him out. Because you just noticed, again and again, Muhammad messed up when it comes to the worshipping the pagans. First of all, let me read the Sahih Hadith, and then I'm going to read the full story for you to understand. Actually, people bow down and worship because they saw Muhammad was honoring their God. It wasn't because Muhammad was honoring Allah, but it was because Muhammad was honoring their God. I'm going to come to that. Quran is well explained, well detailed book. But in somehow, suddenly verses are missing. In somehow, at the right time, Allah just gives, okay, when this surah comes, go to the sajda. Maybe as a Muslim you believe that, you know, that doesn't even happen on coronation streets anymore. Because people grown up now. So, I'm gonna read this Sahih Bukhari, okay? The Prophet performed...
What number? You have a hadith number?
385.
Well, second book number two or what?
Sorry?
Give you the book number?
Book 6, 385.
Book 6.
Yeah.
385. One second. I don't have any...
The Prophet performed a prostration?
Prostration, yes.
Yeah. When he finished reciting the Surah Najm, and all Muslims and pagans and jinns and human beings bow down with him. And then we know pagans had the stars, their God as well. So I'm gonna go to the Tabari, and then I'm gonna give you the reason. Actually, why did...
Can we talk about the Hadith?
I'm gonna come to that, just a moment.
Okay.
It's my turn now, remember? I'm gonna go to the Tabari, and then I'm gonna help you to remember what was actually the reason. Okay? And then I'm going to tell you what Muhammad said was the reason. Okay? Have you told Al-Azad, Al-Uzra, and Manat, the third of three? Satan, when he was meditating upon it, desired to bring him to the people, to his people, put upon his tongue. Those are the exalted blah, 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 blah. When Quraysh heard, they were delighted and greatly pleased at the way in which he spoke of their gods. Quraysh people worshipped, prostrated, because they were pleased how Muhammad talked about God, or about their God. Please address that point when it comes to your time. When they were delighted and then they prostrated, and they listened to him, while the believers were holding that what the Prophet brought from the well explained, but fails to give us the reasoning. Remember, Abbas, remember. They,
as a context to that, when Allah says as well detailed,
Quraysh others who were in the mosque prostrated when they heard the mention of their gods. It's not they heard the mention of Allah, it's not they heard mention of birds or flyers, they heard mention of their gods, which is in Surah 53 verse 19. Okay, only one person didn't bow down, and then it goes on. What had been said about their gods, saying Muhammad has spoken our gods in splendid fashion. He alleged in what he read that they were exalted. Garania, someone whose intercessions are approved. Okay? The news reached the Prophet's companion, who were in how do you pronounce this place?
Abbasinia.
It being reported that Quraysh had accepted Islam. So, some men started to return, while others remained behind. Then Gabriel came. Okay? Gabriel came. Who is Gabriel? It's the one who brings the word of Allah according to Islamic tradition. He comes and then says to Muhammad, what have you done, Muhammad? Have you read to these people something I did not bring you from God? And you have said what he did not say to you. Gabriel is not saying to Muhammad, Muhammad, yes, it was time end of the chapter 53. Bow down, prostrate, go to the sajda. Muhammad is not, Gabriel is not saying that. What Gabriel is doing, Muhammad, why did you tell them something I did not bring to you? Why did you do that?
Is there a hadith you're reading or you're reading?
I'm still reading the commentary I've been reading.
Well, I'm telling you, commentaries are not our yardstick.
Sir.
It's the Quran and Hadith.
Sir. Bring me something, discredits that. I've got the biography of Muhammad.
I'm going to bring a hadith.
It's my turn. I've got the biography of Muhammad, which is earlier than this. Okay? They confirm. Let me read the wonderful part of it. Okay? The apostle was bitterly grieved and was greatly fear from God. If it was the time of the finishing of the surah, why Muhammad grieved? Why Muhammad was afraid of the Allah? Why?
It
says, didn't you listen? He was greatly fear of the God. So God sent down, for he was merciful to him, confronting him. Yeah, confronting him and making light of the affair and telling him that every prophet and apostle before him desired as he desired and wanted what he wanted, and Satan interjected something into his desire and his desires and wanted what Satan wanted.
Yeah.
And then God sent down the revelation, we have not sent this to prophets, blah blah blah. So if your account is correct, I am afraid you have to throw under the bus the Quran. I am afraid you have to crucify Muhammad from the hands and feet, according to Surah 47 and Surah 8 and Surah 4. You have to kill Tabari. You have to kill the earliest biography of Muhammad. Then you end up with a book. You end up with a book which makes a claim well detailed, well explained, yet it is not. So, as I made my point, Surah 16 talks about people who worship, who commit shirk, are the friends with Satan. Surah 53 confirms Muhammad is friend with Satan. Therefore, it's not only Muhammad should be killed once more again by poisoning or something else, but he should be taken out from the life of Muslims so Muslims can have peaceful life. So can you just examine this passage which I read it for you and then tell me what's happening?
Okay, now again, I ask you to show me where authentic hadith backed up the story of Ibn Hisham or Tabari following Ibn Hisham. Any authentic hadith says the same thing. Because we know Quran didn't say the same thing. Quran actually, on the contrary, says these are the names which you and your forefathers has made and Allah has not given you any authority. Quran is completely refuting it. It's Ibn Hisham and Tabari are saying that. No authentic hadith. Secondly, you say I have to throw the Quran under the bus and hadith. Why you use the word Quran?
Maybe burn, not under the bus. Maybe you need to burn them because that's what
Uthman
did. Anyway.
I don't know why you bring Quran in the same level as Ibn Hisham or Tabari. Quran not saying that. Quran is not backing what you saying that. Who said that this story was Ibn Hisham? And Ibn Hisham is not my yardstick. It's not my.
He's not my
yardstick. I don't follow it. I don't measure my religion through Ibn Hisham. Neither I measure my religion through Tabari. Tabari was a great scholar, of course. Great scholar. But there are many other scholars, commentators. Yes, those who mufassir, who write commentaries. Did they say the same thing as Tabari? Is their understanding is the same? I'm sure you are aware. No one else. I haven't read all these commentaries.
But you should read because lots of commentaries agree.
I know Ibn Kathir didn't say that.
I know for sure
Maududi didn't say that, which I believe Maududi's commentary is one of the best commentaries for the last century. He was a great commentator. So it's one person's view and understanding. One thing is for sure, my yardstick Quran didn't say that. Quran, on the contrary, refuted as I said. Neither authentic hadith says that. So why would I throw the Quran under the bus? Why would I reject Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? So these are the stories concocted, made up stories. Either in the best intention, they made an error and mistake. Secondly,
so who made the error and mistake?
Yes,
who
as,
made
a,
it?
As a human being, Ibn Hisham,
okay.
Ibn Hisham, and Tabari followed. Now, why I say that he prostrated in the last at the last verse, as you read earlier commentary, when the surah finished. Then they prostrated. Now suddenly in the middle you change, or when they heard the names of their God, then they prostrated. So there's a bit of contradiction in your statements. Earlier you said, when the surah finished, then they prostrated. And surah finished, the verses are, how many verses are in the surah? Let me see.
50 something?
You can't, it's my turn, remember? Be generous.
No, I was giving you
There are 62 verses in that surah. Allat and Manat was mentioned in the 19th verse. So there are 43 verses in the middle. What they were doing in the middle 43 verses? Because the commentary say when the surah finished, then they prostrated. Not when the name was mentioned. So you need to understand, you need to think about it, why they waited till the surah finished. My claim is this, when the surah finished on the verse, prostrate yourself. Now why I say that? I can back up with ahadith, which you failed to back up. There are ahadith which tells us there's not only one surah which has this prostration verse. There are other surahs as well. In Bukhari, chapter book 17, hadith number 1076. Now this is talking about different surah, not Najm, but surah Sajda. When the narrated Ibn Umar رضي الله عنه, when the Prophet recited surah Sajda and we were with him, he would prostrate and we also would prostrate with him. And some of us would not find a place to prostrate. So there is another chapter he's talking about, not Surah Najm. When there's a verse of prostration comes, everybody prostrate. So there's no Lat, Manat and Uzza mentioned in Surah Sajda. Then there's another surah as well. Surah Nahl is another surah. Umar bin al-Khattab recited Surah Nahl on a Friday on the pulpit. And when he reached the verse of Sajda, of prostration, he got down from the pulpit and prostrated. And the people also prostrated. What these hadiths are telling us, then there are verses in the Quran, when it comes, when Allah say and prostrate, that kind of command comes. When Allah says, and the past generations, when they saw, they prostrated. So whenever we heard that, we, to His Almighty, we prostrate in our humbleness, that we are also among those who prostrate. So this, in Surah Najm, what you're saying, when Muhammad worship the idols, this is your interpolation. You are putting words in it. Even the commentary never say the Muhammad worship the idols. What it says, he prostrate when the surah finished. So Muhammad did not worship the idols. He only prostrate when the verse comes. You need to understand that. So your case that anyone who was under the influence of Satan, when they worship anybody other than Allah, is a friend of Satan, is a false position to take.
Okay,
you can't back that up with any hadith or the Quranic verse.
Okay.
Only you are calling Hisham.
Let me respond.
Did I answer all your questions? I don't
know. Let me respond. I think we just focus on this one. If you,
yes.
I don't think you answered all my questions because I told you to crucify Muhammad, blah blah. You didn't deal with them things.
No, but
here's
that's
the thing.
Just a side
here's,
point.
Here's
why
the thing.
Do I crucify? I refuted
here's
you.
Here's the thing. I can see you're seriously digging hole yourself to find the ways to express your love to Muhammad. I can see you are doing your best to twist what the Islamic tradition is telling us. I can see and I feel for you. I feel for you. Because of that, when I proposed you last week, maybe you should become a god instead of being paid to debate with me. Maybe you should become a god.
It's a very difficult job.
I'm sorry every week you pay to debate with me and you find that job is difficult, but you need to learn to enjoy your job.
With you.
So,
oh, it's so easy.
Sir, it's my turn. Let me finish. As you dig into the Islamic tradition, first thing you did was you discredit Ibn Hisham. What is the date for Ibn Hisham? 833. Okay?
Yes.
833 is the date for Ibn Hisham. What is the date for Tabari? 323. Okay? What is the date for Bukhari? 870. Does Bukhari tell you how the Surah 53 verse 19 to 23 revealed? No. Give me the context which is against this one, against Ibn Hisham, against Tabari, tells you context was something very different. You have nothing. So you stick on, oh, this is because prayer, reciting the surah finished, when they went to sajda, that's what they did. And then you show me the symbol from your Quran. Can you please give me one Quranic manuscript that sign exists before Ibn Hisham, before Tabari? Answer is
I don't have those manuscripts.
Answer is no. So what we see here is, even though you are digging hole for yourself, even though you are trying to take Muhammad out of that grave and put in high place, Gabriel steps in and then says to you, Abbas, no. As he says to Muhammad, why are you reciting something which I did not recite? I'm grateful. careful seriously that you are forcing your view in the Islamic scripture. As a Christian, something I cannot do. I cannot force how I interrupt my scripture or add the stories in my scripture. My scripture is done and finished. But we see, as you throw the biography of Muhammad, as you throw the Tabari, you end up in a book which doesn't even make sense. It doesn't even make sense. I haven't finished yet.
Because you make a lot of statements and
so,
I have to back it up.
The points,
remember what you said.
The points Qurayshis are making. None of the Qurayshis are saying Muhammad bowed down when he finished the prayer. So we all hang out as a good family. They are saying because he mentioned our gods. And now this news went to the Abbasids, and what happened? News went that they become a Muslim. What happened is, Muhammad deceived these people. Gabriel steps in, he confronts Muhammad what he's done. Muhammad freaked out because he noticed he did something was wrong. He become friend with Satan, which in Surah 16 we hear about it. What happens is Allah steps in. All heavenly beings suddenly steps in and hang out with Muhammad. But the point comes, even though you try to take Muhammad out of the grave, you force him to end up in seventh floor of hell. Because Muhammad become a friend with the Satan by not only committing shirk for himself, but also allowing all Ummah to commit shirk, worshipping the Quraysh pagan gods. And if you provide something for me, which discredits the context of the discourse, we see they discredit, and it needs to be early from this because those are much, much early sources. Provide the Quranic manuscripts, which has the sign of the Sajda as well. Let's do one more and then we finish, okay?
Yeah.
Make your last point.
Okay. Again, I think I must explain to you again. I'm sure you already know that, but you're ignoring the fact. We Muslims, we follow Quran. Quran number one, first. Then we follow the traditions of the Prophet, peace be upon him. We call them Sunnah and Hadith. This is our criteria, come down. Not the commentaries of the Quran. They are not, neither biographies of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They are not our yardstick. Now, you may claim that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used the words in praising Allah, Manat and Uzza as the cranes of God, as the mediators of God. That's what Ibn Hisham says the story was. But when I read the Quran tells me something different. Quran says, remember this is my yardstick, my textbook. What the Quran says, these are nothing but names that you and your forefathers have invented, for which Allah has sent down no authority. For me, that is enough to know that Allah, Manat and Uzza are the names made up by the pagans and their forefathers, and Allah has given no authority. That's it for me. I don't need to pick up Ibn Hisham. But you know what? Before it was given authority, but later on it was changed. Quran is not saying that. That's my yardstick. Second, authentic hadith, which back up this verse of the Quran or the story of Ibn Hisham. You didn't show me any. Thirdly, you say they prostrated. I show you why they prostrated. The commentary never says that Muhammad wasn't prostrated to worship the idols. Commentary never say that. You're just adding into it. Commentary say that he prostrated when the surah finished. And you need to understand why. Because you have a biased position. You want to understand the way you like to understand, not the way things are. He only prostrated because the last verse says, and prostrate with those who prostrate. We call, as I said to you, we call, what's the verse in Arabic? Sorry.
Sajdat al-Qirat.
What's the verse? Ayatul Qirat.
Sajdat al-Qirat.
Sajdat al-Qirat.
prostration or recitation. That's what it says. Last verse, one more time I'm going to read it. Prostrate yourselves before Allah and serve Him. When Muhammad read this verse, recited this verse, he prostrated and the Muslim prostrated. Now, why the pagans prostrated? Who cares why they prostrated? Pagans prostrate, they worship many gods. Allah was one of them. They never reject Allah. Pagans never reject Allah. They believe in Allah and the other gods as well. So why Muhammad prostrated? Because the verse saying that. What other point you make? So this is, I want to put that into bed. Don't keep going back into Hisham. My criteria is not Ibn Hisham. I don't need to look what Hisham is saying, that when Quran is saying on the contrary. You want to hang on into the third, fourth source of Islam, biography and commentary. I want to hang on to the highest source, Quran, and then Hadith. But you didn't show me any from the Hadith and the Quran that what the Ibn Hisham say that. That is his comment, that is his understanding.
Okay. Let me finish then. So here's the thing. Surah 16 tells us people who are friends with Satan, they also worship pagan gods. They also commit shirk. And then what I've done was, I looked at the Surah 53, which throughout Islamic tradition known as the satanic verses in Western countries, that Muhammad had the verse not from God, not from Gabriel, but from Satan, and he prostrated for pagan gods.
That's your
when you look at the Islamic tradition is making it very clear. People bowed on because they heard their name of their gods has been mentioned. If it was because it came end of the chapter, remember, Muhammad would not freak out. Muhammad would not fear from Allah. But Muhammad knew he deceived people. Now people are confronting him. I'll encourage you to go and check your sources. It is amazing that suddenly you start sticking only the Quran and all after the Quran, the Sahih Hadith. Here is the problem. Even if you stick on the Quran, when you throw out biography of Muhammad, Hadith down, you know what you end up with? You can't even end up with orange juice. It becomes something not even drinkable. Because Quran does not make sense if you don't have the biography, if you don't have the commentaries. Well-detailed, well-explained Quran once again fails. So, without Quran, you are not able to tell me who are those pagan gods. Without Quran, without other writings, you are not allowed to tell me actually what is happening, what was the context of the revelation. Well-detailed, well-explained Quran once again fails. When you look at the earliest writings are saying to us, Muhammad received this revelation from Satan. He built a bridge with Quraysh. They all prostrated. Quraysh prostrated because they heard their name of their gods mentioned. It doesn't say because Surah 53 is finished. You have no hadith, no any Sahih Bukhari tells you actually what is revealed in Surah 53. You've got nothing. You can't even give me the isnad. You can't even give me the chain. So stop inserting into your scripture. You need, as you come to speaker's corner to tell people about Islam, to do dawah, let me strongly encourage you. Go and read your Islamic sources instead of just throwing them under the bus, putting them in the grave, chopping them, cutting them, pasting them. That doesn't help you. That dishonors Allah, and that it butchers not the Quran, but it butchers Muhammad. And you wouldn't want to do that because according to your so-called well-detailed, well-explained Quran, Muhammad has pretty high position. And that doesn't help you. Can you please go home and then figure out what was happening in Surah 53, 19 to 23, while Muhammad had this revelation from Satan? And then we continue on that next week. And also you owe me to have a debate on the reliability. No, it's finished.
Well, you didn't.
And you owe me.
I have to end. You started it, so I have to end.
Okay, finish.
Okay. Now, first of all, the point before you make, I want to remind you, you say you don't do that in your scripture. In your scripture, you don't add things and you don't take out things. Actually, this is a lie, you know that. We know now, in the Bible, there are many verses that are added.
Sorry, Abbas, this is your conclusion. If you just talk about the topic, that will be helpful to you.
It's my turn.
I'm just telling you, like, how people do the conclusion.
I can even speak about the grass or the buses. It's my time. Let me make my point, because you said it. We don't do that in our scripture. We know that. Even Jason is standing up here. He will say, yeah, there are 40 verses which have been added and they were not part of the Bible. He will say that. So this is your actually lie when you say that. And so bravely say that. I don't know if you're ignorant or you're just deceptive. The point again, I want to remind you, when you say your Islamic sources, what you're actually basically saying is a biographer by the name of Ibn Hisham. He said this story. So this is my Islamic source, because somebody wrote a biography on the name of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I must follow it. No Muslim have to follow every single biographer.
You know, with that,
it's my turn.
Let me make a point.
No, you can't. I didn't make the point.
Okay, Just finish your point.
You see that what she does? You always try to distract me.
Just finish
your point. So, our sources are not every biographer ever lived. And not every commentator. Our source is the Quran. So anything contradict with the Quran, even a hadith, my yardstick is the Quran, I'm going to leave it aside. Now Ibn Hisham's story contradicting the Quran. Quran says, I did not give you any authority on it. So how can, when Allah says, I don't give you any authority on those gods you call, how can Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saying this thing and then bowing down to those gods? Doesn't make sense. So I don't need to even look into it. Who said it? That contradicts the word of my Lord, my God. So I don't have to go into detail who's Ibn Hisham. I reject it. Yes, we do use commentaries and biographies help, as long as you do not contradict the Quran. As long as they do not contradict the facts of history, which we learn over the years. As long as they do not contradict the authentic hadith. We have no problem learning about them and taking as a reference book just to extend our knowledge. But not when we contradict, we leave it behind. So that is your answer. So you didn't prove. I'm going to back to chapter 16. Chapter 16 says, if those people, I read that verse again. What chapter 16 say that? Surely he has no power over those who have faith. Okay. He has power, Satan has power only over those who take him as a friend and who under his influence associate others with Allah in his divinity. And you prove nothing. Then Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam never worshipped anybody other than Allah. That is the story of Ibn Hisham, that by Tabari, not any other Mufassir, neither authentic Hadith, neither the Quran. So you didn't prove anything that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam worshipped anybody other than Allah. So that proves the point. He was not under the influence of Satan and he was not a friend of Satan. He cannot be.
So if Quran is... If Quran is your stick man, what do you call that?
Yardstick, yes.
I am afraid I have to tell you, your yardstick has been chewed one of my dogs. Okay? It looks like my puppy just chewed your yardstick. Because Quran itself contradicts itself. And if that is your criteria, man, you messed up.
That is another argument.
You messed up. So, just a moment.
That was not the argument.
We finished. I'm just making my last statement. If Quran is the yardstick for Muslims, I am afraid my dog just chewed that. Because Quran contradicts itself. If you go anything against which goes against Quran, and if you discredit them, you crucified Muhammad. You poisoned Muhammad because Muhammad went against Quran. Muhammad contradicted Quran. But we will continue that next week.
He didn't show any contradiction.